Kenyan and Ugandan traders recently signed a memorandum of understanding to help end continuatives and some of the non-tariff regulations. This, according to experts, is expected to reduce delays and cut down on bureaucracies involved in doing business across the region. We hope that this memorandum of understanding is implemented successfully and effectively, knowing that some of these have been signed in the past, but we still see complaints arising within the region. Welcome to the Business Show. Now, here are some of the stories that are making headlines in the world of business. Stanbic Index blames Ukraine war for trade slowdown. Uganda shilling maintains a stance after Easter festivities and works on Gulu Logistics Hub complete.
The tax system in Uganda is mainly relying on the indirect taxes.
Don't plant everything. Specialize in hay, do it better. Specialize in silage, do it better.
Welcome to the show. Now, a new research report has established that Uganda has made minimal steps in establishing a fair taxation system. This, according to observers, is mainly attributed to a regressive taxation policy, which has seen low-income earners being taxed more. In Views from the Top this week, we speak to Francis Odokorachi, the country director of Oxfam, on Uganda's taxation policies and how they are affecting revenue collection.
My name is Francis Shanti Odohorach. I'm the country director for Oxfam in Uganda. The Fair Tax Monitor Report, this is the third in the series. The first time we had, the first report was in 2017, and the one of 2021 that we have just launched examines the Uganda's taxation system for the last five financial years. It's a unique evidence-based advocacy tool that was invented by Oxfam and Fair Tax Network Africa. And it really demonstrates how Uganda is progressing in terms of its taxation system to meet its domestic resource mobilization targets. So the main highlights of this report, it examined the impact of COVID-19 on the taxation process in Uganda. We noted that in this report that the government had a big shortfall in terms of its revenue target to be realized for obvious reason. The economy was under lockdown, but I think the key issue that stood out during this period is that the government, to balance the shortfall in its revenue, the revenue that it raised, it had to come up with other austerity measures, which included budget cuts on some of the social services like education, health, agriculture. Now, the challenge is that when you cut in some of these sectors, it affects the women the most. And because we know a majority of the people who benefit from some of these social services like education are women, health are women. So a cut in this area, this report actually focuses more on the gender aspects of taxation in the country and how it does affect the different demographic categorization of people in Uganda. And we realized that this time we needed to focus on that. Another area that we also noted is that during this time of the COVID-19 response that the government had around its taxation, if at all there was anything that the government could listen to from the IMF and other international organizations like the UN, was for the government to make its taxation more progressive in such a way that it will be able to respond to the social services and the support that is needed, especially during this time of the COVID-19 pandemic. Mm-hmm. So this report speaks a lot about that. The second area that this report examines has been in the areas of the taxation burden and its progressivity. This report tells us that the tax system in Uganda is mainly relying on the indirect taxes, which in many cases is more regressive than progressive. And while there has been some strides towards making the tax system in Uganda less regressive, there is still a lot that does disproportionately impacts on the women. Let's take, for example, the taxes that has been put on the on airtime, for example. The impact on the low-income earners is higher than on the high-income earners. And we see that the indirect taxes does impact on more the less income earners, which for us is less distributive in nature. And I think it is the main reason why the government has to look at how it can tax more the high income earners and the wealthy in such a way that it can even increase on its revenue collection.
Okay.
So that's one of the areas that we have also been able to highlight in this report. The revenue sufficiency and the tax leakages. Mm. We have already mentioned earlier that, you know, the government had big shortfalls in terms of its budget, the revenue that it was able to collect during this period. Mm. We have seen that the tax to GDP ratio for Uganda is just about 13%, which is far less compared to the sub-Saharan African average, which is about 15 to 16%. Even Rwanda has higher, about 14%, which is higher than for Uganda, and even Kenya about 15 point something, which is higher than for Uganda. So Uganda has to do a lot in terms of reducing the tax to GDP ratio. And one of the areas that the government can really, really take a good leap in is around the illicit financial flows. Mm. We have seen that it's costing Uganda about 2 trillion annually in terms of the losses that comes in different ways. And one of those areas that, you know, the government can easily curb on is on the tax incentives that it gives to the corporations, mm-hmm. the corporate bodies, and the wealthy. We have seen that Uganda is losing about 5,000 billion annually in terms of incentives that are given to mainly foreign corporations and multinational companies. Now, this is amount which could actually fund our health budget, it could fund the education budget, as well as agriculture. So if you look at it in terms of the amount that Uganda is losing to incentives, it's about 30% of the total revenue that it could raise, which is significant. And I do think that this report provides that space for the Ministry of Finance and Economic Planning to ensure that it can also revisit its taxation policy.
Okay, quite elaborate there. Now, one would ask then that Uganda is more like a playground where people are asked to come in, we'll give you land, we'll give you electricity, we'll give you what they call cheap labor, and then you can take home some money whenever you want, all in the name of attracting investors. Just how risky is this for a country like us that is trying to raise revenue? And like you said, those who earn less are paying more.
It is very healthy for an economy to attract investors. The challenge for Uganda is how we negotiate with the investors and how we lose resources that we could have, in a very good way, generated from these investors. I'll give you an example. The double taxation agreements that we have with so many countries, the Netherlands and other tax haven countries, stops the government from charging almost about 15% on the revenues that some of these companies do have. And we know that some of these companies do have offices, we call them, you know, the briefcase offices, in some of these countries where they're actually not originating from. basically to avoid paying taxes to Uganda. So it's okay to invite and make the environment conducive, but to negotiate better. So government must renegotiate its double taxation agreements with most of these countries. Then we will be able to reduce significantly on the gaps that now we are experiencing in terms of the deficits from the revenues the government is collecting.
All right, date is not bad, but just how you spend the money is what makes date bad. The question then would be, should we be alarmed as Ugandans if the government continuously, you know, borrows on our behalf?
Well, you know, many of the countries do borrow. Many of the governments do rely on borrowing. But I do think for Uganda, the debt to GDP ratio has been increasing. Let us look at the period between the financial year 2017 and 2018. I think the ratio was 4.1%, and now it has gone up to, as of 2021, 2022, it has gone up to about 6.3%. This is of course worrying. This is of course worrying. And it also means that the public debt is now standing almost at 46.7% of the GDP, which to anybody, even for yourself, if you're over-borrowing and relying on, you know, loans that you cannot be able to balance with what you need to use for your household, that would become alarming. So I think the way that the government can be able to make a shift in terms of reducing the debt to the GDP ratio for Uganda is to basically look at its taxation system and make sure that it is more progressive, to tax more the wealthy and the rich, and make it more redistributive for the less wealthy people, which are mainly the women and the people who are, you know, more marginalized. I think in that way, the government will also be able to generate more in terms of its revenue. And in that way, I do think also, if the government can focus more in terms of allocating the budgets to social services sectors, that would also, in a way, encourage more taxpayers to come in. At the moment, there's a lot of taxpayers who are not paying fairly what they should be paying. Mm-hmm. So I think strengthening of our compliance system would be important. But most importantly, people need to know why they pay taxes. If they know why they pay taxes, they will be able to come forward and pay their fair share and get their fair share of social services. Okay. It is challenging if you're a good taxpayer and you're not getting the services that you need from the government. In many ways, this do discourage taxpayers to participate in this exercise, which is very important. If you look at the kind of demographic trend in Uganda, you will realize that women are less in terms of, there are less people who are paying, like payee, who are in the formal employment. Majority are men. And women are mainly in these informal sectors, which, as we have been talking, they are not being fairly taxed. So even during this response to the COVID-19 impact on the country, I have seen that there were some measures that were put to try and reduce the burden on the women. But the challenge is that while they were given some of these opportunities to lift up their businesses, they were also taxed unfairly. So I think while the government is offering a good hand this side, from down it is taxing them unfairly. That means that many of these businesses would not live to see the 5th year of their survival. So I think while the government will be focusing on trying to elevate the situation of the women, it needs to significantly review its taxation system to make sure that at least we can tax more the rich and ensure that the women who are mainly in the informal sectors, of course they are paying tax, they are paying VAT, they are being charged on the airtime and the excess duties. The fuel prices, it's higher. So they are mainly on the commodity, and that's why with the current hike in the global commodity prices, women are suffering the most. And the other way that also the women can be supported better is that compared to their male counterparts, women spend about 30 hours compared to men who are spending just about 12 hours doing some of this unpaid care work at home. Now, if you are also taxing them unfairly and also cutting the allocation to some of the social services like health, definitely it means that we are not treating the women fairly in terms of our taxation, in terms of how we can support them to lift them out of the situation where they're in. So I think the measures that would be more important is to make sure the taxation is more progressive, allocate resources to those sectors that do benefit women the most, recognize the unpaid care work in terms of how you design your policies. In this way, their businesses will have less knock-on effect, and that means they can survive more and grow their income.
Well, it's very clear that government must ensure that it enacts progressive tax measures that increase revenue collection from wealth and corporations. Let's now go for a quick break. Stay tuned. The business show returns shortly.